In part one, we looked at a few different methods you can use to render rivets. For part two, I'll show you guys the method I prefer to use when I'm working over a metallic or any specialized base coat, and we'll also take a look at the panels that you often see with this effect. Okay, in part one, I talked about how I don't necessarily like to use a white when I'm working over any kind of specialized base coat. And what I mean by specialized base coat is anything with a metallic pearl, anything highly reflective when it's under good light or outside under the sun. The interesting thing is the black or the transparent black can actually create dead spots in the reflectivity as well. If you layer it on thick enough, it will cover up some of that base coat and those metallic particles will not be allowed to reflect through the black if you put it on thick enough. We'll talk about that more here in a few minutes. To begin, I want to show you guys the way I prefer to render rivets over a specialized base coat. And it starts with candies. Candies are 100% transparent. Regardless of how many coats I put on here, it will still allow all those little metallic particles to reflect through the candy color. So I prefer using candies when I'm doing this effect over a metallic base coat. So I've mixed up some candy 2O black, and it's one part of candy 2O black, one part of the 4030 balancing clear, and one part 4011 reducer. So it's a 1-to-1-to-1 mix for this particular application. So to begin with, we'll begin by creating a rivet. It's essentially the same process that we used in part one. I'm gonna use my stencil, the big shield, to create a rivet, and it's the same process. Our light source is coming from up here, so I'm going to create the shadow on the bottom side of this rivet. Candies are a lot thinner, so it'll take a few more coats to build this up. I'm working very light layers. If you hose it on, it will spider out on you, or you can get a flood stroke. Move the mask, and you can see that we have a nice little shadow on the bottom side of the rivet. So if we can't use white, how are we going to create the highlight for this particular rivet? We use negative space for the highlight when you're using this method. So I'll go back to the 360 shield and do the same thing, the little trick I showed you on the other side of the panel. That's how I create the highlight and the definition for the top portion of this rivet. Here's another little trick. If you're going to use your shields, your freehand shields, over and over and over for this effect rather than using a cutout vinyl mask or another mask that you've cut out, I mentioned in part one that once you start getting paint built up on this freehand shield, it makes it very difficult to line it up so that I can see exactly where I want to be. And if you get it off, it's pretty noticeable. So you can take a paper towel and either rubbing alcohol or Windex. I'm using rubbing alcohol because it works a little bit faster and a little bit easier. Spray it onto the paper towel and you can wipe the paint right off. Make sure it's dry before you put it back onto the canvas, because the rubbing alcohol will strip the paint off of the surface you're painting on as well. So now that I have the mask cleaned off, I can see better to line this up. And again, I'm going to bounce the color off of the freehand shield. I just want a very slight sliver going around the top of this rivet just to define it. So line this up. And that's really all you need. It's not extremely noticeable, but it's just enough to set off the top of that rivet. I could probably go a little bit more on the top side. And that does a pretty good job of defining the top of the rivet. So now the negative space becomes the highlight. Now when it comes to the center of this rivet, if you're going to put that hole in the center of the rivet, if you're not confident in your airbrush skills, if you don't have the control to put a very small dot right there, again, you can use the freehand shield. Like I mentioned before, it's going to get covered with paint as you paint more and more of these dots, but you can use Windex or the rubbing alcohol to clean that off. So for this one, I'll use the stencil, mark this off, and same process. Now I'll go darker for this particular portion because this is an actual hole in the rivet itself. Remember to use the air to dry it. Now it's slightly off center there, but it doesn't look terribly bad. Which brings up another point. Contrast is relative, remember that. So now that we have that very dark hole in the center of this rivet, we could actually come in and darken up the bottom shadow a little bit more. So I'll take the stencil, line this up best I can, and add a little bit more of a shadow. I don't want the shadow to be as dark as what we did in the center of the rivet, but I wanted it to be just a little bit darker. Same thing for the definition on the top of the rivet. We can come in and put just a little bit more. That looks better. You want to remember to work progressively. Build up your value slowly, especially when you're working with candies and you're doing something like this, because if you go too dark too soon, working with a candy, there's pretty much, you're very limited as far as how you can fix this. So work it slowly. That looks pretty good. Again, we've got the highlight now created through negative space, and you could even take it a step further if you get a little too much of the candy up in the highlight. You can take an eraser and redefine that highlight if you need to do so. So for the shadow, we talked about the distortion in the metal. If we were imagining we're punching rivets into this piece of metal, it's a thin piece of metal, so it's going to distort the metal to some degree, ever so slightly. It's the same process that we used over here. So if our light source is coming from up here, we'll have a shadow directly above the rivet. And this you want to go very lightly, just like we did on the other side with the transparent black. A little bit goes a long way here. probably go just a little bit darker. So now we need to create the highlight underneath the rivet in the distorted portion of the metal. Again, we don't want to use white because white will create a dead space on this panel where it will block all the metallic particles from being reflected under good light or outside under the sun. So I'll use the same method basically as we did for the rivet head itself to create the highlight in the distorted portion of the metal through negative space. It's the same process that I showed you on the two lower rivets on this side of the panel. Using the 360 degree shield, I will put one of these circular shapes, hovering it above the panel, probably 3/8 to maybe a half an inch, and I'm going to very lightly bounce a little bit of color off of the shield and onto the panel. So it's probably a little bit far out, but you can see now we have just a hint of a shadow on the metal itself, and then it leaves you with a little bit of a highlight right here through negative space. So here's one more option that you can choose to throw into your rivets if you like. This is not 100% necessary to do, but it's another option, another thing to throw into your toolbox. What I've done is I've taken Candy 2O Marine Blue and I mixed some Candy 2O Black with that Marine Blue, so it's darkened up the color quite a bit. It looks like this right here. The other option you can do for the highlight in the distorted metal is you can take just a very, very, very light amount of this color and put just a hint into that area we created the highlight on through negative space. And what that does is, think about chrome, how if you render chrome, you'll have the horizon line is usually very dark, almost black, if not black. Above that, you'll have what's reflected from the sky. So you'll have blues, and then below, you'll have the browns, which is reflected from the ground, the earths. So just a hint of that blue kind of gives you the reflection, the illusion of the reflection from the sky. So again, that's just an option. You can use it if you want, but it's not 100% necessary. You can also use the blue versus the black on the bottom side of the highlight in negative space. Now, if you do that, I wouldn't use the blue in the highlight itself. Just options, guys, but that's pretty much the method I use for rendering rivets over a metallic base or any kind of specialized coating that has a lot of reflectivity. Okay, we've looked at the method I prefer to use when I'm rendering rivets over a metallic or specialized base coat. So now we can get into the panels. There are typically two different ways you'll see the panels depicted with this process. Either you'll have two panels that are somewhat butted up next to each other. There's usually a gap or a space in between them that have been riveted together, or you will see one panel on top of another panel and they've been riveted together. We'll go with the panels that are butted up next to each other first. And about the easiest way to create that panel gap is with a strip of masking tape. So I will lay out a piece of tape on this panel and another piece of tape with a little bit of a gap. That's the panel gap. So now I will come in with the airbrush and the candy black and paint the gap in this panel. Now, we talked about earlier how the black, or transparent black, not a candy, will ultimately cover all the reflective properties in the metallic particles as well. when I'm dealing with a panel gap, I don't have an issue with using a regular black for that gap because it's a space in between two panels that you're depicting. You can use either method. I think they both look just fine. I'm using the Candy 2O black because it's what it was already in the airbrush. So that's pretty well dark and blacked out well enough for this panel. So I will remove one side of this tape. Again, this gap is not very big at all. Here's another little option you can throw into your panel gaps if you choose to do so. It's kind of an extra step, but remember, we've talked about how when we're punching rivets into this simulated metal panel that it would distort the metal to some degree. Well, if it's distorting the metal around the rivet, then it stands to reason that there would probably be a little bit of distortion in your panel gap as well. It's not necessary, and actually a little bit more realistic, I think, in my opinion, to have not a perfectly straight panel gap. But another option you can do is come in and put a bend in that gap. So using the 360 degree shield, I'm going to add a little bit of a kick out right here. Nothing crazy, but it bows out just a little bit. Now I'll remove the other side of this tape. And you can do that as many times as you want, but you don't want to get too carried away with it. Less is more when it comes to these effects. Now to finish off that little gap, because now it looks like this side of the panel has just a little bit of a bow in it. So to really pull off the effect, you would want to add just a little bit of a shadow underneath that bow. So using this 360 degree shield again, and I'm going to keep the shield off of the panel about 3/8 to a half an inch and just dust a little bit of a shadow right there, and it gives you the optical illusion that there is a slight bend in the metal panel or simulated metal panel in that area. And through negative space, you wind up with the highlight on this side. You could even come up just a little bit above and put another very light, very, very, very light shade of this black, and it even sets off that wrinkle in the panel a little bit more. That's essentially all you need to do for two panels that are butted up next to each other. The only other thing I would do is continue the rivets down both sides of this panel. And that brings me to another point. Oftentimes, when you're looking at this effect, if it's done on a vehicle or a motorcycle helmet, something to that effect, we'll usually find already existing gaps, like the gap between the front fender and the door. And a lot of times, if you really pay attention, you'll only see the rivets depicted on one side of that gap. You can get away with that. Realistically, yes, there would be another piece of metal underneath these two panels, and you'd have to rivet both sides together. But painting these rivets takes a considerable amount of time. So depending on the client, the budget that the client's working with, a lot of times I will only paint the rivets on one side of the panel. If they request that it's done on both sides of the panel, that's fine. But it costs an additional amount of money. So just something else to keep in mind. So now we can move on to the panel that is riveted to this panel sitting on top of it. So the easiest way to do this, in my opinion, is I've taken a piece of photo paper just because I had it lying around, and I've cut out a rectangular shape with rounded corners. So I have a positive and negative stencil, essentially. So what I'm going to do first is take a couple of pieces of tape and tape this on to this panel about where I want to make this panel. So the trick here is, because we're not using white, ordinarily if I were painting this in the traditional method and I was using white, I would use white to put a sliver of a highlight along the left side of this panel and along the top, because again our light source is coming from up here. Because we're not using white, we have to create the highlights using negative space, just like we did with the rivet. So to create the top left hand portion of this panel, I'm going to put a very, very light coat, just dust coat, of this Candy 2O Black on here. And that will separate the panel from the rest of the background. Again, this is very light. It doesn't take very much at all. Pull this up and see how that looks. I think I can work with that. So from here, I will take the negative part of the stencil, if I can line it up correctly. I'm going to tape this down in place. And I can remove this one. So now I can create the shadow. Hopefully this makes sense. So this will be the panel, the shape of the panel that has been riveted onto the top of the existing panel. So now I want to create the shadow along the right and the bottom side. And I'll do this the same way, spraying onto the shield or the stencil, whatever you want to call it, more than I am the actual panel. I'm not going to go full dark like we did with the panel gap, but it'll get relatively dark because, again, this is a shadow. Remember, working light layers. Dry it with the air if you need to. Get the air under it so I could lift it up and see. I think that looks pretty good. Now, much as we did to make the highlight through negative space in the top of this rivet with just that sliver around the top of the rivet, I'm going to do the same thing in a few key areas around this. I don't want to spray a dark sliver line all the way around the top or the left corner. But in a few areas, I'll throw it on there. Let's see what that looks like. Again, this is not spectacular. I went a little too dark and a little too wide on those dark areas around the highlight end, but it is just a test panel and I'm trying to keep this time sensitive for the YouTube video. So from this point, the only thing left to do is to come in and paint the rivets around the panel and on the sides of these two panels that are butted up. I will do that off camera. One thing I will mention is when you're doing a rivet, say in this corner where we've got that little bit light wash of candy, don't forget you can come in with your pencil eraser and erase the highlight back out of the rivet to keep that highlight intact. So off camera, I'll go ahead and spray the rest of these rivets. I'll throw some clear on it, let you guys see it, and then you can see the results for yourself and choose what you want to use. For whatever reason, anytime I tell you guys that I'm going to clear coat a panel so that I can show you what it looks like under good lighting, it's always either overcast or raining here, and today is no exception. It's been cloudy all day, it's been raining off and on, so I did the best I could under the conditions that I had, but I think I've got some good footage that will at least show you guys the metallic reflective properties of the base coat on this panel. I finished off all these rivets off camera. Full disclosure, I was in a hurry. I've got other stuff that I need to be doing as well, and I rushed every one of these rivets. I went way too dark on all of these rivets, and it is what it is. I'm not gonna make any excuses, but this was just a test panel. It was more about showing you guys the different methods you can use to render rivets. So if we look at the first example, again, this doesn't look bad, and if I'm working on any kind of just a solid base coat, this is the method that I will almost always choose to use because it looks awesome. But when you look at it under light, you can see the reflective properties, all those little metallic particles that are bouncing off the light are blocked from the white. That's the reason that I don't particularly like using the white on any kind of specialized or metallic base coat. If we go to rivet number 2 and 3 that we painted, where I used the aluminum base and the pearl white, the aluminum base actually surprisingly blocked the reflective properties from the existing base coat as well. I was kind of surprised by that. I think it may have to do with the fact that I got a little bit heavy with that aluminum base on this rivet. Again, it doesn't look bad, but it doesn't look as good as it could, in my opinion. And again, guys, these are my opinions. This is giving you options. You pick what you like. I'm not saying this is the way. These are different ways. It's up to you as the artist to pick what you like and what you want to do. The pearl white actually looks pretty good. The pearl white does not block the metallic base coat from reflecting any of those metallic particles. And when the light hits that pearl just right, it acts like a pearl and it really glows. That highlight stands out. So it actually looks pretty cool. The downfall to that is the light has to hit that highlight just right to really make it pop. As I said before in the instructional part of the video, rivet number 4, this is the method that I prefer to use when I'm working over a metallic, pearl, any kind of specialized base coat, because it's so clean. And you can really see the difference between the shading on this one that I did as an instructional on-camera demonstration versus all these others that I rushed through. You can see how light the shading is around this rivet. That's what you really need to concentrate on when you're doing this kind of stuff. Keep your shading light. Unless you've got a very hard shadow like around this plate here, keep your shadows light. It looks so much better, this rivet does, compared to all these other rivets. But again, these are all just options. To get that highlight, I use the eraser off camera as well. So there you go, guys. I hope you got something out of this. This turned into a little bit longer video than I had anticipated, which seems to be pretty much normal for me. But it gives you some different options, some different ideas, things to try, and don't be afraid to experiment on your own. That's how all this stuff is figured out in the end. It's from guys just trying different stuff. Sometimes that's passed on, sometimes it's not. So I hope you got something out of this. If you did, remember to like, subscribe, and share. I'm Trevor with Wicked Art Studio. I'll see you guys next time.